For more videos on people's struggles, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Hello and welcome back to Around the World in 8 Minutes, where we at People's Dispatch are with you every week to bring you stories of people engaged in struggle across the world. For our first story, we take you to Argentina. March 24th marked 45 years since the US-backed military coup in Argentina, which installed the bloodiest dictatorship in the history of the country. In 2002, the Argentine Congress declared that this tragic day would be remembered as the National Day of Remembrance for Truth and Justice. In 2006, it was declared a public national holiday in Argentina. On March 24, 1976, a right-wing coup overthrew the constitutional government of Isabel Martínez de Perón and replaced it with a military junta headed by General Jorge Rafael Videla, Admiral Emilio Eduardo Macera, and Brigadier General Orlando Ramón Agosti. The regime remained in power until the return of democracy in the country on December 10, 1983. During the 7 years of dictatorship, over 30,000 students, activists, trade unionists, writers, journalists, and artists were kidnapped, tortured, and disappeared. Since 1986, every year on March 24th, hundreds of thousands of citizens, relatives of the disappeared people, members of several social movements, human rights organizations, and political groups of Argentina march to the Plaza de Mayo in Buenos Aires to remember the 30,000 disappeared people and demand justice for the crimes against humanity committed by the state. This was the second year in a row that the day's traditional marches and commemorations could not take place due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Social and political movements in the country, as well as civil society organizations, took to social media to condemn the atrocities committed by the dictatorship and organized small symbolic actions in plazas and squares across the country, planting trees and reciting the names of the 30,000 comrades that were tortured and disappeared. Our partners in Argentina, ARG Medios, spoke to Nora Cortinas, one of the founders of the Mothers of Plaza de Mayo, an organization formed during the dictatorship in response to the state terrorism and repression. She spoke about the coup in 1976 and the forced disappearance of her son, Gustavo.
¿Cómo cambió tu vida? ¿Cómo viviste vos el golpe de Estado del 24 de marzo de 1976?
Bueno, lo vivimos con mucha ansiedad, con mucha angustia. Primero porque para esa fecha, desde el año 75, estaba preso el cuñado de Gustavo y los dos militaban juntos. Entonces, cuando da el golpe de Estado y la mamá de Paco, que estaba en contacto con nosotros, nos dice que él se había podido comunicar diciendo que esa noche del 24 de marzo recibieron palos por todos lados, represión muy fuerte adentro del penal. Entonces vislumbramos unos días terribles que iban a venir y que no sabíamos qué esperar, ¿no es cierto? Bueno, ahí nos enteramos que el mayor castigo fue adentro de los penales. Digamos que como despedida, los militares hicieron un desquicio de represión, persecución, golpes, bueno. Entonces veíamos, pero no tanto de lo que se venía a venir. No tanto, no que iba a haber miles y miles de desapariciones, con torturas, con gente que fue arrojada al mar y al río. No pensamos que eso iba a venir de esa manera. Entonces, esos días fueron cruentos y fueron de mucha incertidumbre. Desde luego que las madres todavía no salíamos a la calle, no había empezado la desaparición forzada masivamente, compulsivamente, indiscriminadamente. Después se fueron dando las acciones de los militares, los allanamientos, la prepotencia, llevarse a la gente siempre golpeándola, así fueran mayores, iban a buscar, no estaba el hijo, se llevaban al padre, al abuelo, y siempre con violencia. Bueno, no, yo recuerdo eso, y de ahí fue hasta que se llevaron a Gustavo, que fue un año después, fue como un torbellino de enterarnos de represión y de represión. Gustavo con Ana se tuvieron que ir a vivir a la clandestinidad para que salvarse de esa persecución infame. Y bueno, y tardaron un año hasta que el 15 de abril de 1977 se lo llevaron a Gustavo y desapareció desde ese momento.
¿Cómo te relacionabas vos y el resto de la familia con la militancia de Gustavo? ¿Cómo la veías? ¿Cómo la percibías?
Bueno, teníamos miedo. Él iba a la Villa 31. Había decidido apoyar los movimientos sociales, pero resulta que ya había desaparecido. No, habían asesinado a Carlos Mujica el 11 de mayo de 1974. O sea, que ya estaba el aire caldeado, ya estaba el signo de lo que iba a venir siendo la represión. Pero nunca imaginando, nunca, de que iba a ser de esa manera. Entonces, lo que yo digo es que ni ellos sabían, los militantes, que se iba a desplegar un operativo de represión. Primero fue en el 75 el operativo Independencia en Tucumán. Y ahí vimos la ferocidad, hasta el día de hoy que se está destapando la olla, la ferocidad de los militares para eliminar toda esa juventud que luchaba para cambiar el mundo.
We now go to Algeria, where the Supreme Court ordered a retrial in the case of the well-known journalist Khaled Rareni. Rareni was slapped with trumped-up arbitrary charges and was sentenced to a three-year prison term last year, which was reduced to 2 years on appeal. Rareni's conviction for covering the historic Hirak movement protests in the country was widely condemned by human rights groups, Hirak movement figures and press freedom organizations such as Reporters Without Borders. After the news broke, Rareni expressed the hope that the new trial will correct the two trials that he faced. He also expressed disappointment at the country's highest court not ordering the proceedings against him to end and forcing him to go through a third trial in less than a year. Rareni, who is a correspondent with French language TV5 Monde and RSF, was arrested last year in March and was detained without charge or trial while he was covering the Hirak movement demonstrations in the country. In 2019, the movement successfully forced the longtime president Abdelaziz Bouteflika to resign after being in power for 20 years. Rareni was subsequently charged with inciting an unarmed gathering and endangering national unity. The so-called evidence was social media posts expressing concern for the country's political system. He had also expressed support for the Hirak movement and for the opposition political parties. He was also charged with criticizing the subsequent government and the president of Algeria, Abdelmadjid Tebboune, for highlighting issues of misgovernance, corruption, and political apathy, which were increasingly becoming endemic to the country. During his detention and trial, a massive national and international campaign was organized by activists, journalists, and human rights groups who staged rallies in solidarity. According to latest data from the Algerian National Commission for the Liberation of Detainees, around 30 Algerians are still being held in prison for their participation in the Hirak movement or protest movements, despite the government recently releasing 40 political prisoners in a seemingly conciliatory gesture. Finally, we take you to the United States, where anti-racist activists who have faced heavy state persecution finally received some good news. Activists from the Party for Socialism and Liberation, Lillian House, Joel Northam and Elisa Lucero had the first-degree kidnapping charges against them dropped. They were arrested on September 17 in heavy militarized police raids along with activists Terrence Roberts and Russell Rutch. They were then put in jail for 8 days while awaiting bail and slapped with heavy charges including first-degree kidnapping, inciting a riot, participating in a riot, and attempting to influence a public servant. Together, these charges could mean a prison sentence of around 50 years. On Thursday, March 25th, a judge in a pre-trial hearing decided to drop the first-degree kidnapping charges against the activists, arguing that the demonstration on July 3rd, 2020, which the charges are connected to, was a peaceful protest. The organizers were in the forefront demanding justice for Elijah McClain, a 23-year-old who was murdered by officers from the Aurora Police Department, a city next to Denver, on August 24, 2019. No police officers have been arrested for the murder till now, and the district attorney, Dave Young, had announced on June 25, 2020, that there was not enough evidence to rule McClain's death a homicide and punish those involved in that line. The activists and supporters are hopeful that this ruling is the first of many, and the rest of the bogus charges will also be dropped, and that first and foremost, those who committed the crime of killing Elijah McClain will be brought to justice. And this is all the time we have for now. Keep watching People's Dispatch.